subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Well, hello, Jai Hind, Namaskar, Assalamu Alaikum, Sat Sri Akal, whatever. But we are so happy to have you all with us on our first digital off the cuff. Because one, Corona or no Corona, the show must go on. But more importantly, coronavirus has now increased our anxiety levels and curiosity levels in every area. So while we listen to doctors, scientists of one kind, we also have to listen to doctors and scientists of another kind, because all of us are concerned about the state of our economy, global economy, what will happen now. So will there be a tomorrow, or will there be a day after, and what will the day after look after? So I talked about doctors of the economy, so who better as our first guest on our digital off the cuff than Dr. Krishnamurthy Subramaniam. He's actually so much younger than me. He was born in the year I passed class 10 that he says it's okay for me to address him as Subbu. So Subbu, welcome to OTC. You look in remarkably good spirits for the times. And I do have a brilliant set of audience, who all of whom I can't see, but they've logged on. Many of them have already sent in their questions, and they will keep on sending their questions. So I will keep pitching those questions to you. So first of all, if I may ask you, how bad does the situation look with the economy? Or let me say, let me not load it. How does the situation look with the economy? Because it's not as if pre-corona days, our economy was in the pink of health. We still had declining growth, declining exports, and lots of problems.
So first of all, to all our viewers, let me wish them good health in these uncertain times. So Shekharji, if we think about the COVID episode, I think it's fair to say that none of us, including people like you, would have encountered anything like this during our lifetimes. We've seen swine flu, Ebola, and others, etc., but nothing of this kind of magnitude. So in some sense, therefore, we are all living through a new set of events, and therefore there is significant uncertainty. There's uncertainty on the epidemiological side, on the health side, and on side. Just like other scientists and researchers, we're also trying to, make the best estimates in this uncertain environment. I think the best proxy to sort of use to be able to say something, meaningful about the current episode would be the 1918 Spanish flu. That's because if we look at in terms of the what is called this R0, and by now I think a lot of our viewers would have been familiar through WhatsApp messages, etc.
You are said PhDs in R0 now.
Right. So the R0, and I was just reading this interview by Larry Brilliant, who was involved with the movie Contagion, and he was saying that the R0 for instance for smallpox was of the order of 3.5 to 4.5. For the common flu is anywhere between 1.1 to 1.3. The Spanish flu was about 2. And for the COVID, it's about between 2.2 to 2.4. Therefore, the Spanish flu is quite a comparable, and I think therefore the learnings from that can be quite useful. It has been the biggest pandemic so far, and touch wood, I hope that the COVID does not rewrite history. As of now, if we look at, I think we are far, orders of magnitude away from that. So touch wood again on that aspect. So overall, if we, the Spanish flu, 500 million people were infected, and 50 million people actually, had to suffer death as a result of that. What is quite important to learn from that is there's been now, research on this flu itself has increased substantially. I want to show a chart that, you know, this is for the United States, which, you know, it's in some sense, we're actually, this is like deja vu, because the lockdowns and the, you know, the non-pharmaceutical interventions like closures of schools, closures of churches, closures of you know, shopping centers, etc. This was something that was seen 100 years back, and we're actually seeing the same thing again. So what this chart shows, and you know, let me actually try and see if I can have that chart loaded here. So let me skip. So could the chart be shown, please?
So while you load that, I'll just underline the fact that for Donald Trump, it's always 1917 for some reason. He calls it Spanish flu 1917, but it is 1918, guys.
Actually, 1918, interestingly, you know, the Spanish flu had three waves, and the second wave was by far the most, you know, debilitating, and which happened in 1918. So while that chart gets loaded, what I want to actually mention, the main point there is, so, you know, many economists and others have actually, you know, spoken about this trade-off between flattening the epidemic and the impact on the economy, that there is a trade-off. So if we take, you know, more intensive measures to flatten the epidemic, the economic costs may be larger. And that's the theory, that's a conceptual argument that has been made. What is quite interesting with this evidence, actually, this is for the United States, various different, you know, various districts. What is shown is that actually in you know, counties, or which are basically the equivalent of districts in India, in those counties where the interventions were faster, you know, were basically done much earlier in advance, and where the interventions lasted longer, the impact on employment, you know, it subsequently in the next 4 years, after the pandemic was over, was much, much, much larger. In other words, there actually was no trade-off. In some sense, actually, like, jaan bhi tha aur jahan bhi tha, you know, as a result of the... So that is what, you know, that chart shows very clearly. I hope if that chart can come up. So I think the learnings from that for the current episode are also quite crucial. I think we have been, you know, on the first part, which is, you know, imposing these restrictions early, I think we've done a good job. For instance, the R naught, which basically, you know, after the lockdown seems to have come to about 1.5, which means basically one person is infecting about 1.5 persons. So that's actually low. And I think, you know, being able to extend some of these aspects, which is, you know, school closures, you know, malls, etc. Some of that, it will be important in this, you know, fight with this, you know, with the pandemic. Overall, the decline in the growth, actually, you know, economically speaking, the United States, for instance, had a decline in GDP of 3.5%, you know, in the year when the, you know, when the pandemic was very strong, but then bounced back to actually have a growth of 7.5%. the next year, okay? Indeed, actually, the V-shaped relationships, and now people have, you know, come up with these characters, you know, V-shaped, you know, U-shaped, L-shaped. So it turns out that even in the Spanish flu, the economy in terms of the GDP output level of output followed a V-shaped, and it was back. So I think it's also important to remember there are behavioral, you know, aspects that come in whenever we talk about episodes like this, that, you know, there is an element of actually fear that comes in, and we're all humans, and therefore some of the projections may be actually a little bit more, you know, pessimistic and you know, that than what may actually translate. The lesson seems to be, so what I am mentioning today for the Spanish flu may seem like, oh no, you know, this is, I don't think we're going to have much worse. But the evidence, I think, is very clear, because as of now, the, you know, the infection rates as well as the rates of deaths, etc., are orders of magnitude lower. 1/3 of the population was infected in the Spanish flu. And now we actually, you know, currently we're actually less than a percentage point in terms of the overall population, much less. So overall, I would say that there will be an impact like no other that we've seen in our lifetimes, but may not be as bad as we're imagining in our worst case scenarios.
So, I mean, first of all, What you say is very correct, because in American debate, I hear a lot about the comparison between Louisville and Philadelphia, because one imposed a lockdown and social distancing, that's Louisville, and Philadelphia had a parade. So Philadelphia had a much larger rate of infections and deaths, while the other one did. So that logic is taken well. But tell me something. You've been to an IIT, right? You've checked all the boxes. IIT, IIM, and then Chicago, right? And you've done your PhD with really brilliant people. Your Raghuram Rajan was one of your supervisors. So there used to be that book, I'm sure it still sells on footpaths, called What They Don't Teach You in B Schools. So you are now dealing with something which they don't teach you in a B school, in an engineering school, or in an economy school, isn't it?
That's a good question. So I would say that a lot of the tools, you know, that we learned actually in engineering, in business schools, and in, you know, during a PhD, do apply. But what is, you know, what is different is that the parameters, you know, that would actually be used to be able to apply those conceptual frameworks or those models, actually, though, that's where we are sort of in fresh territory. So, for instance, you know, the same epidemiological model that actually explains the spread of the Spanish flu can still be and is indeed being applied for, you know, for basically modeling the COVID as well. So the apparatus remains the same. But in terms of whether the R naught will actually be 1.5 as it is, what will it be, you know, once, let's say, the lockdown is taken out, those parameters is where we're actually in fresh territory. So I would still not disband the, you know, thinking apparatus that, you know, people, all of us, we actually learned in various institutions. But we will actually have to use new data, and that is why the testing strategies, etc., become very important to be able to actually parameterize these models very well, not only for the particular Indian setting, but also within India, you know, differences across districts, you know, across states, etc. It's quite important. Therefore, new data, new research needs to really happen to be able to utilize these models and contextualize them really well to the particular environments.
So what do you say to some of these epidemiologists who rely on plain mathematical modeling to say that 60 crores Indians will get infected, 80 crores Indian will get infected. Now we have one very eminent epidemiologist and a genuine epidemiologist, Dr. Mulyale, who says that, look, you cannot turn the clock back on this. You have to build herd immunity. So let the young go out to work. This does nothing to the young. Hide the old people. Tell your old man to sleep under the mango tree if need be. But let this wash through your population. Is that realistic? Is that fatalistic? Is there a middle path available?
So, you know, I am not an epidemiologist. I think I can't do better than refer to what Larry Brilliant himself said about the herd immunity. And he you know, spoke about two aspects. One, while we actually go and acquire, in the process of acquiring the herd immunity, the damage that may be there would be so large, you know, if, for instance, one could actually be having, there could be basically bodies, you know, lying around on the streets, you know, in the process of acquiring herd immunity, that the cost there itself would be very large, number one.
If I can interrupt for a second, just to add to your point, in the 1918 Spanish flu epidemic or pandemic, India lost 5% of its population, 5% died.
Yes. In fact, you know, good that you brought that up. Even I actually had looked up that statistic. India, you know, and this was so people, because it coincided also with the World War, you know, soldiers came coming in and you know, infecting actually did make. So India was one of the worst affected, you know, during the Spanish flu episode. Touchwood, as of now, we are actually doing fine at this point. But, you know, In any epidemic like this, there is absolutely no reason ever for any complacency. So whatever one says about the current you know, point has to be basically said with a lot of caution. But to you know, to come back to the your point about the herd immunity, as I was saying, while the you know while this process of building herd immunity happens, the damage itself will be so large. And this is again actually one of the expert epidemiologists saying it. Second, what he's also saying is that you know it, the threshold at which the herd immunity will be acquired, that threshold is actually not quite well known. For instance, it's possible, let's say, with a influenza or, you know, and he is someone who's actually, you know, contributed to the eradication of smallpox in India. So he knows what he's talking about. You know, I'm again mentioning about Larry Brilliant. So, you know, the threshold at which the herd immunity will be acquired, maybe 90%, 95%, maybe even, you know, who knows, maybe 100%. And without actually good answers on what would be that threshold to acquire the herd immunity, I think it is very, very dangerous to actually to sort of go on that path, you know, both in terms of the damage that will be acquired while reaching that eventual threshold. And if you don't even know what that threshold is, you're basically sort of shooting in the blind.
Yes, so this is direct threat to human life. But what about the indirect threat to human life by way of damage to the economy? So where do you see the growth rate, for example, for the last quarter, ongoing quarter, next quarter? How long will that last and how bad will that be? Or will things get worse before they get worse and then get better?
So as I actually had mentioned, you know, at the outset, there is a lot of uncertainty in being able to, you know, predict any of these outcomes. So the IMF, for instance, you know, has just come up with its release saying that our, you know, maybe about 2%, while the world basically will have a decline of 3%, you know, in its growth. Now, and you know, this estimation has been made with a lot of caveats. This is basically the baseline. The you know, different scenarios could be very different. If we basically are able to, you know, on the 20th, we're able to, you know, open up some of the sectors for activities, and then post lockdown, the way we see the cases, if they don't seem to be increasing alarmingly, I was actually plotting the number of cases. It seems like that actually the slope has decreased. You know, even on the log scale itself, logarithmic scale itself. If that continues, then the impact, you know, on the economy may not be as bad. But I think what is important is also to keep in mind that in Singapore, for instance, and there are also reports coming from China of people who basically got the infection, you know, recovered, and also then again possibly getting infected. This is another, and which relates back to the earlier point about the herd immunity. You know, if there's a likelihood of you being able to be reinfected is high, then the herd immunity threshold may be much higher. So it really depends on these parameters. So what one can only say is these are the factors that we'll have to watch out for and keep recalibrating our expectations for growth as we see this episode pan out.
Well, just for some clarity on these people coming back after recovery, testing positive, the latest science on this is that a lot of it is dead DNA showing up in tests. So what they have is the virus has died, some DNA is left over, and it shows up in tests, but it's not infectious. So let's look at the, I'd rather go with the glass half full side, but what you're saying is absolutely correct. Now in this situation, I have a couple of questions from my colleague and friend, and your somebody you know very well, Ila Patnaik, Professor Ila Patnaik, who says that, are you thinking of any fiscal responses to this? And if so, what would these be?
So, the, you know, as you, as we would have actually noticed there are a lot of countries that have actually come up with fiscal packages, and the government also has announced one, you know, in late March, which was about 0.8% of GDP. What I must actually, before I, you know, go and answer that question, I just, you know, must mention that some of the numbers that are actually being spoken about, for instance, to just take an example, the 15% of GDP, you know, as has been called the Rishi Sunak package for the United Kingdom. I think, you know, we have to be a little careful to not mix up apples and oranges. You know, when we're talking about fiscal stimulus, it has to be about actual cost to the, you know, to the exchequer. Just to give one example, the £350 billion of loans that are, or loans with guarantees that have been announced, the actual cost will certainly not be £350 billion, because, you know, even if, let's say, we were to use proxies from the, you know, from either the global financial crisis or the Spanish flu episode, in the Spanish flu episode, the bank losses were about zero, and defaults during the global financial crisis were 5%. See, if we say that, you know, Spanish flu 0.5%, global financial crisis 5%, let's say 10%, even if we say 10%, it still means that it'll only be 35 billion. So I think it's really important to make sure that we actually are looking at the right numbers. When you look at the right numbers, it seems like there is, you know, there is a certain average, you know, of the fiscal package. And, you know, the government has also been looking at all these aspects. Already there has been a direct benefit transfer that has been announced for the, you know, vulnerable households. There is, you know, the government is working on coming up with responses to others, you know, affected stakeholders as well, you know, firms, for instance, especially the SMEs, etc. So there is a need for a, you know, for a fiscal package, and the government is actually absolutely aware of the need for that.
And you people are working on it. Don't tell us what it is, but you people are working on it.
Yes.
Now, what kind of a hit do you see to your tax revenues? GST as well as direct taxes, or all tax revenues?
So, you know, I can give you some, you know, possibly some baseline estimates, but I think it would be still a little, you know, hazardous, you know, given the uncertainty that prevails, right? So if, for instance, you know, Q1 of FY21, if you're able to get back some of the economic activity, for instance, so let's take it for granted that the month of April is a wash, because, you know, it's not that, you know, there isn't. But suppose we're able to come back, you know, some bit, April 20th, we open some sectors, we're able to open some parts. There will be a significant impact on the, you know, I think Q1 revenues will actually be impacted for sure. The numbers could vary anywhere between, you know, I'm basically looking at a baseline, maybe 1% of GDP could be, but it may actually be different as well. And again, we'll have to watch out. So I wouldn't basically, these numbers that I, you know, we have to take them with a very, very, you know, a strong caveat, because it's very hard to actually estimate. Depends on, I think, the interaction between the epidemiological phenomenon that will pan out and the economic phenomenon that will then reflect the epidemiological phenomenon is so strong, they're so interlinked, that it is very hazardous to actually make any guesses, lest those are just taken as basically the numbers with which, you know, we basically latch on to.
Yeah, so I have two very smart people asking the same question, that is Neil Raheja and Mitesh Mehta, who are essentially asking you, what is it that the government might do for one particular sector in this area of finance, which is deeply stressed and which could collapse, and that is non-banking finance companies. I know that you don't want to answer any questions which are in the RBI's domain, so I'll be careful not to, but I think this is a larger question right now.
So there are various options. You know, if you go back to the global financial crisis, the bailout, you know, the TARP package that was used, you know, that could be one of the options. These are all being considered at this point in time. Our Reserve Bank has already announced some forbearance for basically loans and extending that forbearance to NBFCs as well. Is an aspect that has to be considered. I think, you know, your point about the NBFC sector and overall the banking sector itself, a combination of, you know, of forbearance and liquidity support is, I think, quite critical to be able to actually, you know, handle this particular episode.
Now, there's a follow-up question from Amit Krishnan, who says that, look, you people, that is people in the establishment, economists, you often talk about moral hazard. This came up when IL&FS happened. So is this talk of moral hazard harking back again and again to socialist times, whether it's to do with this kind of support to a sector or with PSUs, etc.? Is it time to move on? Or do you think a moral hazard is a moral hazard nevertheless?
So, you know, on balance, you know, during a time like this, an episode that, as I said at the start of the interaction, that something that none of us have, you know, witnessed during our lifetimes. I think what we really have to be careful is, you know, as they say, ABC analysis, which is the 80-20 rule, you know, there may be some moral hazard, but I think it is really important at this point in time to actually think about the big picture, you know, aspects, which is about the overall support that is required for the economy. Even if there is some moral hazard, I think, you know, that may be, it may be good to consider that at a later stage, not at this point in time.
So you would bet for a more pragmatic view right now?
Yes. Really important, actually. You know, all of us here are actually, you know, quite concerned about the impact on the on various stakeholders of the economy. And I think at this point in time, it is really important to understand, you know, and support.
So I have a question from Arun Venugopal. He's public prosecutor in Directorate of Prosecution, Government of Delhi. We have to be very respectful. Who knows? In the era of 4Cs. And his question is, should the government employees worry about a cut in their monthly salaries in the coming months?
So this is a very specific question. I can answer this question at just a conceptual level, but without going into the specifics. I think it would be right for basically, you know, such decisions to be made, you know, rather than me to be speculating on them. I would say, you know, at a conceptual level, you know, when different stakeholders and, you know, we are a country where the large part of the population earns much lesser than the typical government servant. So, you know, from a possibly an equity perspective and a conceptual perspective, there may be possibly a case for, you know, these are tough times, and all of us actually have to, you know, keep that in mind and keep those considerations in mind. That's what I would say from an equity and a conceptual perspective.
But, you know, young people like you will not remember, but there was a time in our working lives when in difficult economic times, there was something called a compulsory deposit scheme, where a part of our salaries was actually kept back as a compulsory deposit by the government to be paid back later with interest, but taxable interest.
So I think that's sort of along the spirit of, you know, this particular question that, I think what I have seen, you know, in India, and obviously people like you are far more experienced, but during times of crisis, you know, I think India comes together really well. During those times, you know, most of us, actually all of us, you know, are able to understand the larger good, and thereby, you know, put aside basically our differences to be able to contribute to the larger good. And these are actually examples of such kind of gestures, you know, which basically support the larger good.
So I have a question from Mukita Jhaveri of Taurus Trading Private Limited. And she is asking, there is a school of thought led by Nobel laureate Paul Romer that strongly recommends a large spend on universal testing of the population as an important pillar of an efficient way to restart the economy. I mean, some people are talking of an immunity passport or immunity certificate. While expensive in the short run, it can be 1000% more beneficial in the long run when combined with quarantine measures and a vaccine appears. What is your comment?
So I've actually read that, you know, Paul Romer's work, and, you know, he's in fact put out a model as well, where depending on the proportion of testing that happens actually in the, so I think there is certainly merit to the idea, and if we basically relate it to the experience with South Korea, where they have actually done large-scale testing, and you know, the number of cases thereby have actually been controlled, and so there is, I think, you know, that idea has merit, and the increase in the testing that you know is being done is, I think, along the right lines. What I would actually mention is that in order to be able to benefit a lot from testing, and here I'm actually saying based on my statistical, you know, expertise, what I think is important is, you know, even if you basically have a well, you know, a representative stratified sample, as long as we actually, that sample has enough of symptomatic people and asymptomatic people, together with a lot of, you know, demographic and other sociological characteristics that are captured, if you're able to do those tests, then we can bring in the power of, you know, artificial intelligence, machine learning, all that stuff to be able to model this, you know. And I my BTech thesis when I was doing this was many, you know, decades back, was an application of neural networks in electrical engineering. And at that time itself, actually, neural networks were able to do a good job of predicting some of the electrical engineering, you know, sort of episodes, you know, for instance, very high voltages, you know, coming in. Now, the field has moved a lot. There's a lot of learning there. So once we have this testing strategy that includes symptomatics and asymptomatics, and it's a stratified representative sample, it can be used for prediction as well, and thereby being able to identify households and communities that may be at the greatest risk of catching the virus or spread, and thereby the quarantining, you know, strategy can be far more, you know, localized and sharp, thereby you know, being able to actually, after the lockdown, we may, while at the same time also, you know, reboot the economy as soon as possible. So I actually, you know, summarize, the idea has merit, but I would actually tweak it to basically make it a representative stratified sample that includes symptomatics and asymptomatics. I would only add, and this is the reason I'm actually tweaking, is because it is important to also keep in mind the supply of testing kits, which is also a constraint that we need to keep in mind. There is, you know, there is actually work that's going on serological, you know, testing kits, which is, you know, from what I understand from the literature, the serological, you know, kits basically have a higher chance of a false positive, but not that of a false negative, because a false negative actually, you know, it will be quite worrying in these circumstances. So, you know, once that passes basically the necessary trials, you know, in India, then that can be used, that will expand the supply of testing, you know, ability significantly, in which case then we can actually expand the testing strategy to a much larger part of the population. But still, you know, I think a representative stratified sample actually would be good enough. I mean, the kind of strategies, for instance, MOSPI does this, you know, all the time for a lot of their surveys. Some of that expertise could be utilized to be able to design these testing strategies.
Well, for all of you, if you want to understand more about the technical and medical aspects of this, please watch an interview that my colleague, our National Affairs Editor Jyoti Malhotra, has done with this wonderful scientist who's also brilliantly articulate, Dr. R.R. Ganga Khedkar. He's the chief epidemiologist at Indian Council of Medical Research. It's a one-hour interview, but I can tell you, you will watch it like a thriller. It's 1 hour of masterclass on the science of epidemics and on how to deal with corona and testing, etc. So please do check it out. Normally, since I'm a very competitive journalist, I would have regretted the fact that this interview was not done with me, but somebody else. But I'm more than compensated by the fact that it is on the print. So please do check that out. Now, next question, Mahesh Thakkar from Finance Industry Development Council, who once again is asking about NBFCs. So tell me, how worried are you about NBFCs? Everybody seems to think that this is where dominoes will start toppling now. And in the end, maybe two will survive. If I may guess, HDFC and Bajaj maybe, and the rest will just roll over. Are you people sitting in North Block worrying about this?
So, see, overall, you know, compared to other countries that are going into this, you know, into this episode, we are going into this episode with our initial conditions on the financial sector being, you know, a little bit worser than other countries. And so for me, you know, and for the government, the financial sector is a very important, you know, sector to watch very carefully. Of that, NBFC certainly, given what we have seen in the, because the, you know, the initial conditions are actually worse compared to, so, and therefore the attention that is being paid to the financial sector and the NBFCs in particular is actually disproportionate, because we understand that this is something, and I completely agree with, you know, with the comment that is being made. So we are very much cognizant of it.
So I have a question from a senior diplomat now, Judy Goh at the Singapore High Commission, and she says, very simple question, trust a Singaporean, is opening the aviation sector a good idea post the lockdown? So she's looking at May 3, I think.
So I must say, actually, I'm getting a lot of questions that an epidemiologist might be much, much better placed to answer. But I'll still, you know, go ahead and based on, so I've done extensive reading of this over the last many, you know, weeks. And so based on that, I'll answer it. You know, and with the caveat that this is coming from an economist, not from an epidemiologist, I would say that, you know, air travel, especially international travel, you know, and from countries that are actually infected significantly, it would be risky to open that up immediately. I think, you know, even with domestic travel, it may actually be sagacious to be able to act to sort of restrict it. To, you know, to areas which are actually to, you know, to basically those nodal points which are not hotspots. I think that is something which I would actually think makes sense from an epidemiological perspective. But I would suggest that this answer is cross-checked with an epidemiologist as well.
Well, you know, just as we always say that we are a country of 130 crore cricket experts, we are now a country of 130 crore epidemiologists. But You are taken more seriously than all the rest of us. Now, having said that, I have a question from Aditi Fatnis, Embassy of Israel in India. But before that, let me also say that we are now throwing this open to lots of people who are watching us. Please send in your questions and we'll try and take a selection of those. So please start sending your questions. It's now open to public. So this question is, what was the strategic reasoning behind dissolution of the MPLADS fund in order to centralize the fund?
See, this is in times, you know, like now, it is important that different constituents of the population, and especially those that are seen to be more, you know, responsible, have to respond to a crisis like this. And, you know, I actually look at this as primarily a reflection of that.
Okay, so question, I'm going back to Ila, question from her. Many people are saying this is the time for India to get to attract foreign investment that China may lose, particularly manufacturing. Is that something that you're looking at?
So I think I would expand that particular comment and say that, you know, any crisis, much like it actually creates threats, it also provides substantial opportunities. So, you know, I was looking at, for instance, even before this crisis, if the economists use what is called called the Herfindahl Index. It's just an index that measures concentration. And what that suggests, if you look at the, you know, concentration of portfolio investments versus the concentration of trade, trade, you know, has been far more concentrated than portfolio investments. You know, with some specific countries, you know, like China actually contributing significantly. So after this episode, there will be an opportunity because, you know, in especially multinational enterprises would look to actually diversify their trade, their, you know, global supply chains across different countries. And I think India offers, you know, a good opportunity there because, you know, we are of similar scale as China. We have a, you know, young labor force that actually can be utilized for manufacturing. And we also offer a large domestic market. So from that perspective, I think apart from the opportunity that Ila is talking about, which is on attracting, you know, the foreign foreign investment, I think some of the measures that have been taken in the budget, I think, you know, will help in this. And I'll just list out a couple of them. For instance, one of the critical concerns that pension funds, which actually are, you know, are long-run patient investors and investors that bring in good governance as well. For instance, you know, CalPERS in the US actually is given as an example. For them, one of the key aspects that they would represent to us was that the dividend distribution tax, because it was being levied at the level of the entity, and because these, you know, the pension funds are not taxable or not taxed in their own jurisdictions, their after-tax return actually, you know, went down. Now, by removing, you know, that particular and going with the classical method of dividend taxation, what we have enabled is for pension funds, you know, insurance companies, etc., you know, for them to be able to bring in the patient capital on the equity side. You know, on the debt side, what we've actually done is now, you know, we've taken some steps to be able so that the inclusion of Indian sovereign bonds in the index is enabled. And this is actually a very important step because globally, if you look at about $3 to $4 trillion of money tracks these, you know, these indices, sovereign bond indices, passively. And even with a 1.5-2% weightage for India, you know, of this $3 to $4 trillion, that translates into about $60 billion of inflow. So I think the point that Ila has mentioned actually is a good one. And some of the steps that have been taken to enable some of those can be really beneficial. But I would also add that there are opportunities on the trade side, and especially, you know, in the economic survey, we actually wrote a chapter on this, you know, on assemble in India and overall enabling manufacturing, which I think our companies can really think about and you know, work on it.
I don't understand this very well, but on dividend, I do understand that a lot of people still have problems. They still think that there is multiple levels of taxation on dividend. And some of these questions also came up at the finance minister's meeting in Mumbai. So is that an area that you are now paying attention to, or is that a forgotten chapter now?
So see, the change that we made, and, you know, as I was saying, was that, you know, dividends per se, instead of it being taxed in the hands of the investor,
If I can interrupt, is there a differential treatment to foreigners and Indians?
So I think those differentials actually are still existing. Some differentials are existing, but what has been done is to enable especially the foreign investors, and, you know, with a view on attracting patient equity capital, that the classical method of dividend taxation, which is taxing it at the hands of the investor. So just to explain, for instance, I mean, think about a pension fund. Suppose it makes a return of, let's say, $100. Now, if and let's say the dividend tax, you know, just for enabling numerical calculation, suppose it's 10%, right? Because it does not get taxed in its jurisdiction, it should basically $100. But when it gets taxed at the entity level, it only gets, you know, gets $90 in its account, and that then reduces the return that it generates. So that, you know, particular anomaly has been removed, thereby to attract, you know, patient capital in, you know, especially some of the foreign capital.
So you are not looking at any further tweaking of this?
So, Shekharji, I think, you know, in terms of, see, in times like this, we have to really be focusing on, you know, prioritize. And as I was saying earlier as well, at this point in time, I think the support that is required for companies, SMEs, you know, and some of the vulnerable sections of society are far more important for us to be focusing on than aspects like these.
So I have a question from my colleague, Ramya Nair, who covers finance and economy for us. And she says industries, I think she's asking a question that everybody wants to ask. Industries eagerly awaiting the second fiscal stimulus package announcement by the government. Will it be announced after the lockdown ends? Many say the announcement should have been made yesterday.
So I think this is, you know, the exact details of when it will come is better left to, you know, to people who actually it's above my pay grade for, you know, to be able to speculate on this. I think, you know, I can definitely share that that there's been work that's been going on this. I think we should hear from the government. I'm hoping soon.
Okay. Is it something that you are working on, burning the midnight oil, a fiscal relief package for the industry? When this will happen, obviously.
Shekharji, we've been burning the midnight oil since July. And, you know, in fact, now, of course, all the more so, given the scale of the, you know, crisis that we are encountering, as all of us recognize, this is basically a life, once in a lifetime episode. And so all of us want to be contributing the maximum to be able to reduce the difficulties.
Well, if there's Nishreen Tashreefwala who asks, will banks continue to be safe and stable, or will they also get hit by COVID-19?
So you know, let me give you some numbers before I actually get back to that specific question. So overall, you know, if you looked at the bank capitalization and what is a metric that regulators and banking sector experts use is what is called the CRAR, which is the ratio of the of basically bank capital to risk weighted assets, and that ratio. That number was 14.3% for India, you know, on average across banks. And the regulatory norm is 9%. So 14.3% compared to 9%. So there is sufficient cushion there. And of that 14.3% as well, what is called tier one capital. Tier one capital is higher quality capital, plain equity. That itself was actually higher than international norms. Even, you know, in terms of CRAR, the Basel requirement is 8%. Reserve Bank actually mandates 1% higher. So, you know, before we entered this crisis, yes, we actually are, you know, the NBFCs and some of the banks actually had, were having initial conditions, you know, worse. But overall, the banking sector, as I've actually mentioned, you know, earlier as well, the cushion there in terms of capital is, you know, is adequate. But the government remains committed completely to be able to take care of, you know, all the necessary to take the necessary steps whether it is actually being practical in terms of what needs to be done, giving necessary capital, etc., and taking care of the lending needs of the economy.
So I have a question from Neil Raheja, who says, can the government guarantee 20% lending, additional lending to companies which are not NPAs, because they need the money and they need some bit of confidence? It should be a guarantee for the first loss up to 20%.
So these are actually, you know, aspects that are being considered. We've, you know, this there are many ways of structuring, you know, a guarantee like that. We, you know, conceptually, with a first loss guarantee, if suppose 20% of the first loss is guaranteed, then the, you know, the remaining 80% is basically the risk will have to be taken by the bank. In most circumstances, that 20% first loss is more than adequate, because the loss is not more than 20%, and therefore banks typically, you know, will feel very safe to be able to lend. But there may be some residual, you know, risk as well. And so then, you know, another option is to also actually think about guaranteeing a larger amount, and these are all aspects that are being considered.
So now Amit Krishnan comes back and he says, when we listen to people like you, Sanjeev Sanyal, it looks like, and frankly, when we read the economic survey you wrote, it seems like the solutions to our economic problems already exist with the smart minds in the government. But for various reasons, they are not implemented. Is COVID-19 now that opportunity when some of these difficult things can be done? Will these be done?
So overall, I think, you know, we all recognize that India, you know, given the vibrant democracy that we are, we reform well in a crisis. And, you know, this, as I have mentioned, actually is a crisis like you know, nothing else that we've seen in our you know, in our lives. And so there is definitely the opportunity to be able to make you know, to be able to implement reforms. I do agree that, you know, the ideas for what needs to be done, they're all, you know, there. And I think, you know, the time is ripe to be able to, you know, to implement many of these ideas.
So I have a question from one of the captains of the travel and hospitality industry, who doesn't want to be, who wants to remain anonymous, who says that we are desperately waiting for a stimulus for travel and hospitality industry, because that is the worst victim of this crisis.
So we've looked at various, you know, sectors, sector by sector. We've looked at what has been the impact, you know, on the particular sector. And, you know, not just travel and leisure, you know, but also other sectors have also been looked at. So we've actually done a comprehensive analysis of the sectors that are affected, and based on that, you know, the package is being worked on.
So we have a question from Swarabh Pangarkar. Once again, sort of similar question: is government looking at sector-specific fiscal stimuli?
So, as I already mentioned, that, you know, all the sectors, the impact of the, you know, the COVID episode on sectors has been analyzed, and they're all being taken into consideration while you know, coming up with the package.
So I have one more sector question, that is from Dr. Harsh Mahajan, who runs Mahajan Imaging Center in Delhi. And I must make the disclosure that we live on the same street and we are friends of each other. He says the government is not yet focused on the financial health of the private healthcare providers, because everything routine has now been shut. So hospitals, diagnostics, revenues have gone down by 75% to 85%, and fixed costs mostly remain where they were. And they are needed to fight COVID-19, especially if, God forbid, it gets worse. So are you thinking of doing something about them?
As I said, I think, you know, we are looking at all the sectors. We've done an analysis of the overall macroeconomic impact, as well as, you know, sector specific, what is the likely impact of the episode, and these are all being taken into account while working out the package.
So I have a question from Arnab Roy, Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry, who says that, I mean, obviously many MNCs in the past have been investing in China. Is the government doing something, is some kind of a special outreach to get them to come to India instead now?
So this is something that actually had been identified, you know, earlier itself, when, for instance, some of the trade tensions, you know, were manifesting between US and China. At that time itself, the government had actually, you know, identified that this is an opportunity to be able to attract, you know, some of these companies. For instance, you know, mobile manufacturing. We've actually now, you know, the assembling of mobile phones has increased significantly. And what we've seen there is that if the nodal company is you know, setting shop, then all other suppliers also come and, you know, set up operations, you know, in a particular country. So the strategy has been of one of identifying the nodal firm and thereby basically, you know, getting in touch with those firms to enable this.
So do you have a view on universal basic income? Your predecessor and Devesh Kapoor have just written a detailed note on that, basically asking for, this city floats, bad ideas float in the city all the time. I'm giving my editorial view. They charge a wealth tax on people above a certain wealth level and use that money, among other things, to create a universal basic income. Is universal basic income something that's on your radar screen? And intellectually, is it an idea that you support?
So, you know, the salient word in the universal basic income is universal. And, you know, conceptually, what it is also predicated on, and this was, you know, very clearly mentioned in the chapter in the economic survey that Dr. Arvind Subramanian had written, was that the universal basic income would actually be a replacement subsidies. And I think that is a very, very important precondition that we have to keep in mind. You know, that it is a substitute for the existing subsidies, not an add-on. And therefore, you know, if the environment for actually for being able to take out all the other subsidies, you know, gets created, then I think the universal basic income, you know, it being universal, I think can be done. But it's just fiscally not possible to be able to add on the, you know, universal basic income. So that is a very important precondition that has to be satisfied. And that is actually something that, you know, political, you know, debate needs to be needs to happen on that as well.
So let me ask you that dumb non-economist question, which is essentially my question. What do you say to people who say government should just print money? I mean, can you just print money and spray it? Will that create problems or will that bring in solutions? Is that inevitable? And if so, how to do it?
So, you know, that's a very interesting question, Shekharji, because, you know, after the global financial crisis, there is an arm of, you know, of economics, what is called the modern monetary theory, which has been actually advocating this, you know, especially because the interest rates in the advanced economy are quite low, and you know, as a result, you know, it seems like the and you know, and inflation also is low, and therefore the some of the costs with a move like that actually may be low. But you know, and this is something that you would know. You know, in India we had this you know, practice of actually monetizing the fiscal deficit, which we moved away from because that really created a lot of inflation. So, you know, in some sense, this theory you know, that is being propounded in advanced economies is something that India has lived through, you know, many decades back. So I would actually, you know, I think at a conceptual level, what we have to recognize, I think, and this is something that, you know, in an economics class, even an undergraduate Econ 101 is taught, that there is no free lunch. That there is, you know, if you basically, if you move, you know, sort of go and monetize the deficit, there may be a cost in terms of inflation. Now, in the particular situation, this particular year, I would say, and this is something that, you know, we've been looking at. So inflation worries actually would be, you know, I think are lower, you know, because for one, the oil price, you know, is declining, and oil price actually itself is driven a lot by global demand conditions. When global demand is high, oil price tends to go, you know, higher. Given the fact that global demand is going to be quite, you know, tepid in this, you know, in this year, so oil price may continue to be low. Moreover, food prices also actually have come down now. The latest print of the inflation, actually CPI number, you know, shows that. Together with basically the episode itself, which will have impact on consumption, you know, I would say inflationary worries actually are lower. So in that sense, I think a one time is something that can be thought about. The cost may be actually be lower, but it has to be very, one has to be very, very clear that this is an exceptional circumstances, stuff, something that we've just not seen. And therefore, you know, on balance, it may be something that can be considered. But overall, I think we have to definitely remember that there is no free lunch.
So if this money were to become available, how do you think would it be used most prudently? One way is to just distribute it. Donald Trump is doing some of that. I think checks are going out with his name on them. That might be a more vote-friendly way. The other is the Roosevelt way, which is to use this money to build assets, create jobs, create taxes, and to just the New Deal way. So one is the Trump way, one is the New Deal way. What is your way?
So I would say that, you know, there is, I would think about a mix of the two in the, and the economic reasoning for that is the following, that investment, you know, also especially private investment, which is something that is really critical for growth. If you would remember the July 2019 economic survey, we actually showed by analyzing all countries that grew at 5% plus, you know, for 10 years since the Second World War, what we found was that they all grew on the back of private investment. Now, if you actually have to have, you know, private investment going up, private investment does depend on anticipated consumption as well. And so there may be some value to actually, you know, to giving, apart from the from basically taking care of the vulnerable sections itself, you know, if some of the direct benefit transfer is made to sections of the population which will basically rupee for rupee consume it, then the impact on consumption actually would also be, will not be as bad, and that may actually have an impact on investment. I think the infrastructure pipeline that actually has been, you know, has all, you know, the 102 lakh crores that has been already earmarked, that needs to be speeded up, because that will actually, you know, as the economists say, we use this word called crowding in private investment. You know, infrastructure crowds in private investment, so that needs to be accelerated. Overall, I would emphasize that it is really important for, you know, for the money to be spent on capital spending and not as much on just on revenue spending. Incidentally, I think what research for India shows is that during times like this, when, you know, when basically the growth is significantly lower than the potential growth, fiscal multipliers, which is, you know, it's a technical term for if I spend 1 rupee, what's the bang for the buck that I get for, you know, spending that 1 rupee? That fiscal multiplier is very high, you know, about 2 or more. So in other words, you know, you spend 1 rupee, you can actually get, you know, over time, a return of about 2 rupees. and especially on capital spending, I think that is something which is highly recommended. So I would actually say that some part needs to go in for, you know, for basically taking care of the vulnerable sections of society and thereby to boost consumption, focus on the infrastructure pipeline, but also actually encourage investment, you know, and that would be the mix that I would actually think of.
So we are coming towards the end of this session, although we can keep you with us forever, but you are needed to do more important things. Your favorite subject, your pet hobby horse, if I may say, nudge economics. Can nudge economics work in times like these?
Yes, I think, you know, and that's a very good question. So before I actually answer that question, let me just say something which is very important. Behavioral economics, you know, when we think about what are called public goods, you know, whether it's, for instance, sanitation, you know, take the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, or public goods like that. Now, the COVID episode also is creating a public good, which is when I actually pick up the mask and let's say and put it on, then not only am I helping myself, but I'm also helping others. Not only that, if I go and wash my hands regularly, then again, you know, I actually am protecting myself, my other family members, but also the society. So, you know, episodes like this, I think, really bring to light the public good nature of sanitation, of some good habits, you know, on sanitation, etc. And here's where I would actually, you know, mention, for instance, you know, when we were younger, if you went out anywhere, you know, my mom actually, once we came back home, would say, go and wash your hands and your legs, and only then do you come basically and do any activity. Even if we just went out to play in the mohalla, you know, we would come back, basically we'd be told to do that. So this is a practice that again has existed, you know, in our culture, in our norms, and that is something that we basically need to be you know, really tapping into. The other point I would say on behavioral, you know, economics is that episodes like this create what is called the saliency bias, which is that I hear about one person, someone who's gotten infected, then I become very scared. I become, you know, fear basically increases a lot. And sometimes, you know, because of fear, people may feel that they are having to battle, battle this, let's say, on their own. But that is where I think some of the steps that have been taken, some of the morale boosting measures, you know, whether it is actually the Janta curfew or the lighting of lamps or, you know, praising the health workers, you know, and thereby basically saying that this is not a fight that each one of us has to fight on our own. This is a fight that we have to fight it collectively, I think is also a real important way of building that public good of trust, of the ability to basically tackle this episode, you know, collectively. I think that's where behavioral economics, I think we are already seeing some applications of this, but being able to actually sort of do more campaigns, especially identify individuals that are influential, to be able to push through, let's say, regular hand washing, you know, ensuring that we basically take care of sanitation. I think nudge can play a very, very important role because this is finally a public, you know, epidemic, and therefore public good actually is really important to build in, you know, in times like this.
So two things. One, you should not be saying when I was young, because you're still young. People like me should say when I was young.
Well, let me then correct it by saying when I was a kid.
Okay, when you were a kid. All right. And second, I know that what you're saying also makes our common friend or somebody we like and respect a lot, Parmeshwaran Iyer, very happy, because this is one more nudge towards his Swachh Bharat ideas, because ultimately it all comes down to hygiene and cleanliness. Now, I have a follow-up question from a viewer that I'm sure you're going to like. He says that, how do you think will this COVID crisis affect or influence Thalinomics? Thalinomics is an idea that you came up with. You should take the patent for that.
Thanks a lot for bringing that up. So as we had pointed out chapter itself, you know, over the years, many governments have actually done a good job of of actually providing, you know, the basic cereals, etc., for the, you know, and that is something which is you know, helping at this point in time. I would say overall, and this is, you know, earlier when I was talking about inflation, I was mentioning this, that overall I think thali prices, there will be two important impacts on that. One, I think the fact that there is a lot more of the, you know, what is basically being, being kept in the FCI godowns is coming, you know, will be coming into the open market, and therefore the supply of basically cereals will increase significantly. I hope we're able to manage the rabi crop, you know, cutting of the rabi crop well, in which case it will add to the supply of, so overall, I think on the cereal front, I think if you take the thali price and take the cereal component, I don't think the cereal component will get affected that much. But it's possible that some of the vegetables, let's say, or pulses, etc., may change, and we have to see what is the supply demand dynamics for some of the other parts. I think the cooking cost, which basically is also another component which we had factored in calculating the price of the thali, that through the LPG cylinders that are being given, you know, what cooking cost are being given free, I think that also would come down. So I think net, I would say that because the cereal is actually about 50% of the overall price of the thali itself, and together with the fuel price, I would say net thali prices should not actually go up too much. There's a chance they may come down. But I mean, again, as I will, anything that I say about the prediction, I think one has to remember the caveat. We are really in uncertain times. And so, you know, it's possible that the actual realization of some of this may be very different from what we actually are predicting at this point.
Well, the only person who can make predictions without the fear of going wrong is Donald Trump, because even when he goes wrong, his voters don't seem to mind. So since none of us is that, let's not do it. Now, I have a tough economics question that I don't understand. This is Ramya Nair asking. She says there's been a lot of criticism from many quarters, including former RBI Governor Urjit Patel, about the way India is opening up the economy to short-term hot money, but at the same time imposing customs duty on imports.
So, you know, I've said this before, I think, and this is something that I'm very sure Dr. Urjit Patel understands, that when we talk about actually on the trade front, we have to make a distinction between, you know, duties that are imposed on finished goods and duties that are imposed on raw materials or intermediates. You know, when duties are imposed on raw materials or on intermediates, that adds to the cost of production and thereby does basically make the domestic industry uncompetitive. And, you know, we've been very clear, for instance, in the chapter on the economic survey on, you know, on assemble in India, we've said that those that pertain to intermediates and actually components, you know, there the duties should actually be, you know, should be reduced. And that's that, you know, my reading is that has indeed happened. So this distinction, I think we need to be making, rather than, you know, saying sort of making a secular statement that we are actually sort of increasing duties, you know, across the board. I think that which is not quite right. On the side, you know, in terms of the, you know, on the capital, again, I would say that the, you know, is on more longer term capital. Overall, if you look at passive capital, is you know, lot more, you know, stable. And I'll use the parallel, for instance, think about deposits, you know, what are called CASA in banks, current accounts and savings accounts. A large proportion of that is actually very, very stable. So, you know, it basically, there is some variation in CASA that happens for a bank. But, you know, about 45 to 50% of the CASA is very solid, you know, deposits that you get that remains with the bank. Similarly, when you think about foreign portfolio investments as well, you know, especially when you get passive investments, that passive investment actually builds a very solid base that is not very volatile. And the, you know, what we've done so far is whether it's actually index, you know, which is basically something that we've moved towards, that's clearly passive, you know, investment that is being encouraged. And similarly, when you look at equity investments from pension funds or insurance companies, again, this is long-term capital. You know, pension funds have very long horizons and they invest money actually, you know, for based on fundamentals, and they invest for longer horizons. So the emphasis on capital, it, you know, has been on basically more patient, you know, more long-term capital. It is important that we actually do enable capital to come in, because, you know, India is still a capital-starved economy. You know, we really, you know, earlier we were talking about, for instance, we were talking about the New Deal. You know, if private investment has to happen, private investment will not happen without capital coming in. So it is really important also for us to be able to actually encourage capital, capital of the good kind, the patient capital, capital that actually is more, you know, long-term. And that is something that actually has been emphasized upon.
So before I let you go, going back to where we started, or where you started, 1980. So, and whether it will be a V curve or a W curve or M curve, hope not, I don't know. Do you see, I mean, when you look at things, when you foresee things, will you take an optimistic view that this might be like 1918, that one bad year and then a boom after that because there is pent up demand? Or do you think, like many other prophets of doom now say, that this will lead to many bad years?
So, you know, again, let me emphasize why I'm using the 1918 swine flu as I was saying earlier, one third of the population got infected, you know, with the Spanish flu, not the swine flu, sorry, the Spanish flu, one third the population got infected, and the actual number of deaths were, you know, 10% was the mortality of the people who were infected. 10% was basically, you know, had to suffer basically mortality. If you look at the numbers for the COVID episode, you know, the global average now for mortality rates is 3.4%. So it's actually one third of that 10%. Secondly, while the, you know, the Spanish flu infected one third of the global population, at this point in time, of the 0.025% of the global population is infected. So that is what I was saying. You know, we're still orders of magnitude away from the. So, you know, in some sense, the Spanish flu was far, far more intensive. Of course, you know, we are looking at this with the benefit of hindsight, because you're looking at the Spanish flu after everything, basically all the dust got settled. And here with the COVID, it's still emerging. These numbers are something that we actually need to be, even if suppose the actual number of infections is 1,000 times more than what it is now, it will still be 25% of the global population. And even if, let's say, the actual death rates are three times what it has been now, which is 3.4%, we'll get to the, you know, to the Spanish flu. So I feel reasonably comfortable using the Spanish flu as a proxy to actually, you know, to sort of predict what will be the economic outcome. And it was indeed a V-shaped, you know, outcome for the Spanish flu of 1918. GDP declined by about 3.5%, and then followed by 7.5%. So that is what, you know, I think the evidence that what we have, that is what we can go by. I think at this point in time, that is the best guess to make, you know, given what I've just talked about.
So we can conclude this on an optimistic note, either in the words of a friend of mine who always says that no matter how tough the times, tomorrow there will be good old days, or maybe something that many of us are familiar with across generations, Subbu, even your generation, because your Hindi is better than my English. That was a line, Raat bhar ka hai mehma andhera, kiske roke roka hai sabera. So there will be a dawn, this will be over. And when that happens, there will be pent up demand, there will be a sense of relief, and human beings will be human beings. So they will be entrepreneur, and they'll be entrepreneurial, and they will buy and sell once again. So once again, looking forward to those times. And it's been very, very enlightening listening to you. We could have gone on, but as I said, we have to leave you to do more important things. Thank you very much, Umu, and thank you all for logging in. We'll be doing it quite often now, and we'll try and bring you great guests again and again, starting with Dr. Krishnamurthy Subramanian. Actually makes us set the bar very high. So thank you all, and thank you, Subbu.
Thank you, Shekharji, and stay safe, everyone.
Thank you.